And this segment is brought to you by DraftKings Sportsbook, America's top-rated sportsbook and app. Not only are they the best, but let's be real, they're safe, they're secure, and more importantly, the thing that we and you both like, they are reliable. Man, you can't go wrong with DraftKings Sportsbook, but we also have a special thing for them. You know the special thing we're talking about, right? That promo code? So we got this promo code, right? Moats, M-O-A-T-S. If you use the promo code for all the first-time users out there, you will receive up to $1,000 worth of deposit bonus money. Does that sound good to you?
It sounds like a pretty good deal to me.
I mean, it's hard to find anything better than that right now, is it?
It's up there, dude.
So with that being said, you heard it from Deke. You heard it from me, baby. What are you waiting on? Download the app and use the promo code, and let's get that opportunity to make a little money. I look at this matchup. The Jaguars are on tape. They haven't, I mean, this is the thing. They play well, but personnel-wise, they don't have enough. And to me, I even thought back, I know we talked a little bit off-air about some of the different teams that we've seen the Steelers go up against, where it was the Cowboys, the Broncos, and teams like that. I feel like this team, they're a weird mix. They play disciplined enough to keep them in games, but they don't have enough talent to help them win those games. Does that make sense?
I think that's 100% accurate. I'm with you 100%. Yeah.
Like, it's crazy. Like, I watch them on tape. I'm like, they generate some turnovers. I mean, we saw that they created two big-time stops against Aaron Rodgers was a week ago. And then even on offense, it's like they run the ball decent. I mean, James Robinson, he's been looking really good, especially as an undrafted free agent. I mean, what he's been able to do this year.
Fifth in rushing yards.
Yeah, so you see some of the things they're able to do. Even their two receivers, DJ Chark and Keelan Cole, they have a sneaky good seasons as well. Both, I mean, for Keelan, he's on a career year path right now. Obviously, he had the punt return for a touchdown as well, so he's a little multifaceted, but it's not enough. And then obviously with them being down Gardner Minshew, they're going
I'd say that's the main thing. I don't know how much better their record would necessarily be. Maybe they have an extra win or two, but it goes back to the whole Cowboys thing. I think their talent is a little bit less, so no Zeke for them at running back.
Receivers are definitely
are good.
Down.
Like you said, I like Chark a lot, but as a whole, it's not the Cowboys level. And then you have the quarterback. Who's better, him versus Gilbert? I don't know. I mean, it's still, you're on either backup or your fourth string. It's just not a good situation to be in for
absolutely
your offense.
And I think the guy's name was Jake Luton, right? That's what you said.
Yep.
Yeah, Jake Luton. So even with Jake, I think the difference between Jake and Gilbert, I do give a little bit more respect to Jake because he's been playing, he's had to play, you know, multiple games now, whereas with Gilbert, that was his first opportunity. And we talked about how in the past, when it's your first time out there, sometimes because teams don't have enough film on you, you can get away with it. And we knew that coming from the XFL, he had already had some success this season. It wasn't as if, you know, he hadn't played at all and then he just kind of got this opportunity. But with Jake though, man, the thing, he does some cool things. I mean, he doesn't look overwhelmed. I think that's the biggest thing I'm trying to allude to. Because some of these younger quarterbacks, they look overwhelmed. Even when we watched Ben DiNucci get his first start 2 or 3 weeks ago, at times he looked overwhelmed. Jake hasn't given us that vibe just yet. But obviously, from a talent standpoint, he doesn't possess what you need in terms of really attacking you from a passing standpoint. So that's where they're always going to be limited under him, always going to be capped under him. And I mean, that's kind of what you expect when you talk about just later round picks. This guy's a 6th round pick, so you already understand that he's going to have some efficiency or inefficiencies and stuff like that just from a talent standpoint. And you're seeing that when you watch him on tape, man.
I think it's talent, and I think too they're able to move the ball here and there, just like short passes, conservative passes. I don't think that's going to be enough for our defense. I think we're going to expose that, but the times they do take the shots, they've been 50-50. So I think that's the main thing with me for him. I don't think he does have the talent, but also some of the decision-making too, where, all right, they're moving the ball a little bit, but then an errant pick just kind of blows it for them. And that's the thing with them. If they want to stay in games, which they can, just from, like you said, the fundamental standpoint of them playing a game all 4 quarters, to have those type of turnovers, that's going to kill you. And I think that's what happened in the Texans game. He threw a really bad pick. Did they return it to the house? Or
I want to say they did. Yeah, absolutely.
That's kind of the main thing there. It's, if he plays conservative, I think they could maybe stay in it a little bit more than they would if he wasn't throwing picks. But I think our defense is that good.
You know what I equate when I watch them on tape? It reminds me of if we're watching a basketball game, right? You got this juggernaut team on the other side, and you're like, man, we can't run up and down the floor with them. So what are we going to do? We're going to take the air out the ball. We're going to slow it down. We're four corners. We're going to use the shot clock and really make it just this low scoring, you have to execute every possession type game. That's what I see when I watch them. When I watch them versus the Packers, man, I never felt that they had the talent to even be on the same field as those guys across the board. But they did a really good job of just making the Packers have to execute. They eliminated a lot of the big plays and make you have to go, you know, 7 to 10 play drives. And then also on their offense, when they played conservative in terms of running the ball with James Robinson and then the short to intermediate passes with the two receivers, it kept them in there. And then you get a punt return for a touchdown, and now you're like, whoa, all right,
Rodgers,
we got a game.
And Rodgers throws a couple bad picks.
Absolutely. So when I see them, that's what it looks like. They're trying to take, like I said, take the time off the clock. Like, just, we're going to kill this clock right here and then make you have to operate. And you should be able to. And trust me, I don't think the Steelers will have an issue moving the ball on them. But they are just solely waiting to capitalize on your mistake.
Yep.
Because they don't have the personnel to just flat out beat you. And I think for us, that bodes well, because you've seen the Steelers on offense. They've been doing a really good job protecting the ball this year. I mean, it's been night and day, not only from Ben, but from a ball security standpoint, even in the fumbles department.
Yeah.
Those, everything from in that standpoint, man, they've been doing a great job. And it's a reason why their turnover differential is so good in terms of being in favor for the Steelers. The Jaguars, because that's what they lean on and base all their hope and dreams on, I just think that's a bad situation for them, because number one, we don't turn the ball over. And number two, we do a great job of generating turnovers as well. So that's why, for me, I'm very, very confident and excited in the Steelers this weekend.
I'm confident too. It just comes down to if we beat ourselves and do dumb stuff mm-hmm. ourselves. It, like the Cowboys game, we talked about going into that. How the hell are the Cowboys going to be in this? I just don't really see a scenario. It's just got to be a bunch of fluky things
mm-hmm.
like special teams, like maybe a turnover, or, you know, they take a shot and they're able to get something down the field on us for like a 60 or 70 yard touchdown.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how the Jaguars have been able to stay in these
Seriously,
past two games
yes.
with Luton. Like right off the bat in the Texans game, there was a bomb to Chark mm-hmm. for a touchdown. They've gotten some turnovers on Rodgers, the punt return touchdown. So that's like going to be essentially it.
The punt return touchdown really changed the game, because before that happened, it looked like it was about to get out of hand. It looked like the Packers were about to go on this run and ultimately make it a 2-3 score game. They returned the punt, and that changed the whole dynamic of it. And then you get a turnover after that. So it was just negative on top of negative for the Packers. But that's the thing, though, right? For all of those things that have went right for the Jaguars, in the end, you still saw what was the difference. They could not stop the talent that the Packers had, and that was the biggest difference. I think that if it's a scenario where we're turning the ball over and they generate a touchdown or they generate something positive through defense or special teams, I think it keeps the game closer. But I still think that we have more than enough, whether it's offense, defense, or special teams, to make those plays at the end of the game to pull it out, very similar to what the Packers did.